Welcome to the Learning 2019 podcast, where we help you get the most from your conference experience with conference insights and presenter interviews. In this episode, Bob Mosher discusses his work on the five moments of need. Bob explains why the five moments are more important today than ever before and the steps learning practitioners can take to build them into their workflow. Bob has been involved with the Learning Conference for several years and has the unique opportunity to speak with keynoter Sanjay Gupta and others about wellness and workflow learning at the Tuesday morning general session. This episode runs a little bit longer than the others, but Bob's passion for learning and development makes it worth every second. We're sure you'll enjoy it. Mr. Bob Mosher, the man, the myth, the legend.
This wow.
This is really exciting for me to sit and talk with you, particularly because we're going to spend a little bit of time talking about the five moments of need. That was, from my career perspective, one of the most influential books that I've read. Innovative Performance Support is the book. It's available at the ATD bookstore if you're at Learning 2019. A little plug for you there. But a really influential book because of the five moments of needs.
And it was for me. I mean, by the way, thank you for those really overdone kind words. I don't know if I live up to those as much. Just haven't been around a long time. But yeah, and you see, the five moments for me in my own personal journey was, you know, I equate it often to the Kirkpatrick and Phillips pivot on evaluation.
Right.
You know, until they came, and it's not rocket science, right? When you hear the five levels of evaluation, you go, well, of course. But here's the problem. When they came along, we didn't have that. You know, we didn't have a sensible way to talk about evaluation. And then along came this wonderful five levels, right? And so when Dr. Gottfredson, my partner, coined the five moments, at a point in my career, I was struggling with, at the time, blended learning. Mm-hmm. I was trying to do it, and I thought I had. I was at a point in my career working for a wonderful organization that supported that. I had super smart people, PhDs under me in my team, and we released this stunning blended learning thing that didn't blend. It was blended, but it didn't get blended learning. What I mean by that was, when I looked at it through the lens of the five moments, which I was taught at the time, I realized I had done blended training. See, and blended training is very different than blended learning. And I only knew that, Clint, because I had the lens of the five moments to look through, right? So those who don't know, the five moments are when, this is work from a gentleman named Dr. Con Gottfredson, his lifelong work, and he realized that if you look at learning from a needs-based perspective, which we always should, by the way, not a content-based perspective or even a SME-based perspective, which we often do too often, it's truly from the learner's need perspective and designed to a need, there are five. When someone knows nothing, they're brand new.
Yeah.
When someone knows something, but they have to know more stuff, they have to know more new stuff, but they know something, right? So that's more learning.
Right.
Those two fundamentally are very well served and are training, frankly. They're best met through, if you will, formal instruction. But then there are three really important ones that, frankly, are more of what the learner deals with every day, and that's applying, right? It's one thing to master something, which is one and two. It's a whole other thing to be competent at it, which is the application of mastery. And that's the moment of apply, the sweet spot for every performer every day. And then there are nuances to apply. Things change, right? And I've applied, but now the rules have changed. Or I'm doing something correctly, or I think I am, and I get myself into trouble. I have to solve, right? And so back to my story, when I looked at it through those, like the Kirkpatrick story, when I looked at it through When I was able to lay the five moments, which again, when you hear them, they're not rocket science by any means, but when I was able to lay them over my blended learning program that had not worked, I was like, I get it. I know exactly, because I had only blended moments one and two.
Right.
And so okay, so that was where blended training came from, right? So I got a knowledge mastery based outcome, which is what moments one and two help with. I did not get an apply competency based outcome. So I went back to my blended training program. I applied all five moments and I got blended learning, because learning to the learner spans all five moments of need.
Right. That's a fantastic summary of what we go through all day, every day.
Of course.
Like really, that's what you just described. We need to learn new things, and then we need to expound or expand on those things. That's something more. Then we need to use those things. Then things change, and then we get ourselves into trouble, and we need to... are you just really describing life?
Here we go. Now, here's the new word, right? We're describing the workflow.
Right.
That's the baby at the Dolly of the day, right? We call it workflow learning. And I love that because we tried to call it performance support once, i.e. the book that we wrote a number of years back. We label things in our industry. But my problem with those words was when I took them back to the consumer, they're like, oh, okay, if you want to build, what's it called, performance support? Terrific. I don't know what it does, but,
right.
You know, yeah. But if I go to a manager and say, look, would you like me to build workflow learning for your employees that every day while at work, they... learn to perform better. They're like, where do I sign?
Right.
Right. So that's what that, this is the blessing of my journey with Khan, is that he taught me, to your point, that we have to get better at intentionally understanding the work, not the what to know, not the what the SME thinks would be best, not the software that the vendor sold and therefore everyone should use the CRM appropriate. I get all those, but those are the doing of competency. They're not in and of themselves what it's like to be in the work, to be competent in the workflow.
How familiar are you with continuous improvement methodologies like Lean and Six Sigma?
Sure.
Gemba.
The alignment is
go to Gemba.
My
go
God,
to where the
alignment
work
has been stunning. I mean, we threw around agile, right, learning and stuff years back, and Khan's the first to say there's agile software design. There's agile project management. There's agile, you know, we try to do agile instructional design. Very, very different beasts in some ways, but absolutely. And the irony of it is, in the world we live in today, that's work, right? The shelf life of content, nah, you know, good luck with that. The rate of change, record setting. You know, the more with less, like never before. I mean, all the, you know, this
right.
is the work.
Yeah.
And the challenge to us as L&D is, I'll just go right at it because I think it's the elephant in the room. Have we kept up? Has our methodology and our understanding of that kept up? Or do we keep, as my grandfather would say, put lipstick on a pig? And still,
it's a great expression.
And still have a pig, right? And I'll take onus. I think in our industry for too long, frankly, that's what we've done, and not maliciously by any means. But I think we have always, and I don't blame us because it's what we did well. We kept coming back to one and two, because we're so good at it. And Addy and other things have made us be award winning at it. That it lulled us into thinking we were impacting 3 through 5.
So, a little bit off topic here. Because this is something that I've spoken on a fair bit and still continue to have discussions with people about, is I think a lot of the classroom training that we build and the e-learning that we build isn't very good, but we do some of that really, really well.
Absolutely.
And we keep going back, to use the expression, we keep going back to that well. But it's almost as if we keep going back there thinking we're going to fix this. We keep
right.
going back there thinking we're going to fix the
right.
problem of not serving our organizations.
Right. Well,
and then we just keep doing that same thing over and over again.
What's the classic expression, right? Repeating the same thing, the definition of insanity.
Right.
Repeating the same thing over and over again, expecting a different result. And I think we take that too literal and say, well, no, I'm not doing the same thing over again. I'm not doing a classroom. I've moved it online. I digitized it. I have it behind an LMS.
Yeah.
So it's so different.
No, now I'm telling a story.
Here's the problem is that if you look at it through the lens of the five moments, you know, it becomes the lipstick on the pig thing, right? You don't confuse modality with intent or a different design.
Mm-hmm.
A different modality can still be designed very similarly, right? So a lot of e-learning, especially the bad stuff, if I may, is in this lesson you will learn blah 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 blah, and then you know right. But the course it was taken from in page 9 of lesson says in this lesson you will learn, you know, so just changing from paper to streaming does not go from moments 1 and 2 to moments 3 through 5. And so it's an exciting time in our industry because I think we're prepared in no other way in our history to do these things. But at the same time, the gauntlet's down, right? We can't hide behind the moments 1 and 2 stuff because When you get into workflow learning and you start mining user-generated content, all these things we've been chasing for years, content curation, these things, and you really get in the workflow of looking at it, Clint, the thing that's exciting is you find really good stuff that we didn't make or shouldn't ever make. But then the challenge becomes true curation and aggregation. How do you do it? And that's where, again, for me, the five moments gave me the construct with which to say, okay, look, that is a solve asset. That's a change asset. You know, that's an apply asset, right? Just like we got the levels from, you know, that's a smile sheet thing.
Right.
Level one. No, that's right. And that's the beginning of design.
Can you expand on that a bit? When we don't have to go through all five, but let's, because I think we understand one and two. For three, four, and five, the application, the change, and the problem, and those moments of need.
Mm-hmm.
Can you give some simple examples? Like, let's think practically. If somebody leaves this conference and they want to use something at any one of those levels, what are the simple, inexpensive things that any learning team?
Oh my gosh! Well, yeah. Well, that's what's exciting now. That's why I think the time is to a point where we can't ignore this anymore. Because a great mentor of mine once says that the change in education only comes when three things are ready: the learner, methodology, and modality. We can even elevate it to maybe technology, right? And if you look back at our failures in things that you can, at efforts that we tried, early efforts at gamification, not blaming gaming, but early efforts at gamification, early efforts at machine-like or virtual reality or those types of stuff, they failed.
Right.
They didn't fail in because those things were bad. They failed because those three moons were not aligned. So to your question, my ability with SharePoint, my ability with the mature, what we used to call EPSS authoring environments, which are nothing like they were when that acronym was invented, the advent of mobility and mobile devices, the proliferation
Definitely.
Of mobile devices, and the ease with which we can take pictures, create web-enabled things. With those tools, I can go back, find a performance problem, because it should always pivot on a performance problem, not a knowledge need, and build, and then understand is the perform, and then look at the performance through the lens of the five moments. Is it, and particularly the three you're talking about, is the reason they're not, the call center is not performing well in this particular area because they're not being kept up with the change, they're not kept current, and they have old resources and, you know, and poor access to them. Is it a knowledge transfer thing? We took them through product training, but now they're in the context of answering call center questions that are scenario based, and they're not making the cognitive jump to apply. Is it a call center pivoting on problems? People are calling because of things going wrong, which, by the way, frankly, does drive a lot of call center calls.
Certain call centers, they're trying to make that
their only,
it's
right?
It's all online, it's all mobile.
Sure.
Unless you have something you can't solve through those tools.
And so do I, am I then creating simple assets that pivot on solving, not teaching, right? Those are two very different assets, right? So if I'm a call center person and someone says, you know, I lost my luggage, it's an airline, how do I find it? And so I'm the call center person, and I'm like, ooh, boy. And so I pull up an asset, and it's an e-learning on what is lost luggage and where does it go and how do we treat it.
Is that what they do when they put me on hold for 30 minutes?
Possibly.
They're going to do an e-learning course to remember how to do the work?
My point is the mapping, we've misunderstood the importance of the contextualization of assets with availability of them. And so for years we thought, SharePoint and others, that because they're adults, if we group things well and really put a bunch of stuff in there that kind of covers the gamut and is all good, they have the cognitive resources and wherewithal to look at this list of poorly labeled things and go, that's the right one. I'll pick that one.
Right.
No, that one is a 20-minute video. And the person on the line just wants the three steps. And the three steps are in there, but they're 5 minutes in, 9 minutes in, and 17 minutes in.
Right.
So I poorly guided you to the asset based on your need. If I had architected those things such that, okay, look, here's the down and dirty, you know, step assets. No. Here's the background, I don't understand assets. Here's the instructional assets that are going to teach. you know, that type of stuff.
So you could almost have a collection of assets for one particular procedure, one that hits all five moments.
We call it the performance support pyramid. It was an epiphany that came to me, frankly, in an intercontinental flight when I realized that accessibility isn't enough to assets.
Not even close.
Right? There are assets due, and looking through the lens of the five moments, assets meet different needs. And this hierarchical pyramid emerged that at the very tip of the problem that I'm coming in through, the context workflow which I'm coming in through, at the very tip of it, i.e. a pyramid, it's very pointed, focused, small. At the base of the pyramid are these deep, rich, broad, long, time-consuming assets, but my God, they crush the one at the top. But here's the problem, depending on my need going in and my aptitude or understanding, I should be able to say, no, I don't need a 20-minute e-learning. I get it. I just don't know the third step on the cheat sheet.
Or I don't remember a particular code or
the background.
Or distinguishing between two options.
Or I'm not caught up on the latest thing.
Right.
So just, you know, just, right? But we've never architected things that way. It's been all about content collection, not about content aggregation, which is a very different thing. Aggregating content is very different than collecting it. And content management for years has been all about the collection of, mm-hmm. not looking through the lens of, if we said, whoa, if we understood the workflow of a call center person and the problems they face, then we went out and collected assets to meet that need, we would collect them very differently. We would disqualify certain ones. We'd go to certain experts because based on the need I just heard, I wouldn't go over here because that's way too much or off topic or nice to know, but this isn't a nice to know moment. This is a need to know moment. We would do all those things very different. But what we did was we said, look, we have this problem around ticketing. So let's go out to collect all the ticketing things we got. Then the call center person came in through a ticketing instant, a contextual ticketing problem, and was dumped in this vat of ticketing stuff. And
exactly.
It's like, are you, or three systems of ticketing stuff, by the way, because how could more not be better? And so, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
So I don't blame us for the intent. What I think we have to get smarter at is we know a lot more now than we did back then. And those three moons of methodology, learner, and technology have aligned where we can do, where we have seen, in one of my keynote I'm going to be a part of, around workflow learning, I'm going to interview two workflow pioneers in this world that have done remarkable work in understanding that and building great things.
Why don't we transition and talk a little bit about that? So you're hosting Tuesday?
Tuesday in the morning, yep. I'm doing the general session.
Yeah.
I'm also honored to be a part of Dr. Sanjay Gupta's talk on wellness and other things.
Wellness. So we're talking about wellness at a learning conference, and it's taking a good chunk of time.
Yeah.
And in fact, there's quite a few different activities and
yes.
sessions throughout. Why the focus on wellness this year? What's the impetus for that?
See, here's the thing. We are let's go back to the alignment. Let's talk about the learner for a bit. We are a self-serve world now. Google first, if I may, Amazon first. Frankly, before I go to
absolutely.
Right?
90% of online purchases. Right?
And I'm not blasting the brick and mortar. I'm just saying that this is the word. Well, self-help, be it instructionally,
yeah,
the workflow learning, or be it holistically, do I manage stress well? I think the correlation to learning is unbelievable, right? Because here's the problem, Clint. If we're going to create tools to enable learners, we have to understand the world and the context in which those tools are consumed. Highly stressful. Workflow is highly stressful. Failure is terrifying, right? How do I manage my day? How do I attack learning cognitively? What's the brain science behind, you know, cognition and metacognition? You know, and these types of things. This is what a neurosurgeon, right, and this brilliant man we're going to get to hear talk about, if you listen to his stuff, is all about. And so if we're going to look at someone holistically, by the definition, you can't segment. You can't then go back and start segmenting that, right?
Fair enough.
So in the hour and a half of my part, and the other things you're seeing is we're saying, look, if we are maturing into this enabling self-serve world of both learning and life, we have to understand our learners holistically, both through how they should care for themselves, how they handle stress and failure and things that are a part of contextual learning. How do they react to that? What does it do for them? And we can't look at what we build in isolation of that. Because if we don't take the humanistic side into account, that trumps what I know is how many people join health clubs knowing it's good for them. I don't have to read a book to be told. And then I don't go.
Yeah.
Right? So the knowing and the doing thing.
They're related but not connected.
Right.
No
question. So we can build workflow learning all we want, but if we don't take into account the stress of a call center, the reality of the stress and what it does biologically, emotionally to that individual, and then we pile on 78 resources. Is that going to be helpful? No, I'm only exacerbating the problem. Right? But if I understand the nature of the work, the pressure of sales, the stress of leadership, you know, in the context of doing that in the organization that I come from, only then can we create the learning modalities, be them contextual or form, be them workflow or formal, that are going to support the learners across the five moments.
I think that it's an interesting pivot and
huge,
and one that the L&D Scene's comic book. So it's the first 100 comics, and on the opposing page, I collected quotes from individuals that have been reading the comments on LinkedIn. So it's just people inside my LinkedIn community sending in their information. And one of the things that surprised me and caught me off guard a little bit is exactly what you're saying. A lot of people talked about helping people feel, about taking care of their wellness. Justin Lovett submitted a quote. I won't get this exactly right, but it's something along the lines of most of us set out to help people think, not enough of us set out to help people feel. And that's a big part of what we do on a day-to-day basis.
Well, five moments of needs, right? That's an emotional need is an emotional thing. You know, it's driven out of a very selfish, very contextual, very self-centered, which can be bad words. But if you're a worker in the workflow trying to feed your family, keep your job, get promoted, be of value to an organization, I want a person like that. You're right. I want somebody who is a little self-centered, a little, and I don't mean the dark side of it.
Right.
You're right. And so how can we, and part of that is the emotional side of, you know, when here's the interesting thing. When we talk to learners about the five moments, they don't get super emotional about moments one and two. They know they got to know more stuff. They get super emotional about three through five, because when you move into apply, change, solve, for looking at it from their perspective, they're like, "Yeah, dude, if you can getting schooled up's great. I wish I had the time." Moments one and two, but if you can start helping me in the world of apply, change, and solve, there's an emotional reaction to that. Their eyes light up. When we do analysis around workflow. I used to have to beg SMEs to come into a room to help me with training analysis, needs analysis. And they always look at their watch and it's like, you know, they always felt, aren't I doing you a favor? And as soon as the event was over, they couldn't wait to leave the room. Mm-hmm. None of them, maybe they might be nice and say, you know, when will this be done? Or, right? You get what we call BMEs, business matter experts in a room to talk about the workflow. You can't shut them up. You can't shut them up.
Right.
And if you do it well after like sometimes up to 2 days, which I never get a SME for 2 days, after 2 days and they're done, they go, okay, look, what's going to happen with this? What are you doing with this? When will I see what you're, these visceral reactions? But why? Because I'm now talking to them about the highly emotional, highly personal side of what they do and helping them do what they do better. Performance-wise, but also, frankly, maybe even, you know, life-wise. I keep my job. I'm not as stressed call center on it that I can maybe do this for longer than 6 months before I burn out. That's where L&D needs to be. Not that one and two aren't still. I get blasted about this a lot. So you keep talking this three through five thing and kind of downplaying one and two. Nope. The five moments are the five moments. But what I am saying is for so long, we have pivoted on one and two.
Right.
80% has been one and two. I'm saying let's balance the scorecard here with what's most important. And yes, I do not do a solution and not do one and two stuff. But it's 10% of my deliverable.
Sure.
20% of my deliverable.
What about situations where the learning can be built right into the workflow? I used to work with a fantastic CIO. His name's Mike Ludwig, works for Bison Transport in Winnipeg.
Yep.
And His favorite expression, he must have said this to me 100 times, and I don't know that I got it until much later. He said, you don't need instructions to play Angry Birds.
Right.
You can figure it out on your own,
yep.
And if you can't figure it out, it gives you little prompts.
Yes.
What about that type of learning? Like, to order something on Amazon, I don't need to go do an e-learning course to figure that
process
out.
Because you know why? Both of those developers understand the workflow in which that need is met. And they architect the experience such that while doing, you learned. See, workflow learning, another place we struggle is the definition. And when e-learning came along, we used an acronym just in time, JIT, right? Yeah. I would argue it wasn't. Because it might have been from an availability perspective, more than classroom was. But if you went to a learner and said, do you find this e-learning stuff just in time? And you don't tell them what we think just in time is. They go, well, not at all. I mean, because I got to stop my work. I got to remember my password. I got to, when I get into that LMS thing, or whatever, my learning place, whatever we call it, you've branded it. I get, there's like 700 courses. So I got to kind of, and I just asked you if you thought it was just in time. And what we meant was you don't have to come to class on your own time when you want to. And the learner went, you know, that is learning available in the workflow. But workflow learning is available while doing the work.
I like that.
Right? And that distinction is monumental, Clint, in what we build and how we meet the five moments. Because back to my blended learning story, blended training, is I was just making stuff. So here's classic. I took a five-day course. Sound familiar? Made it two. Surround it with e-learning instead.
So you got two full days for a five.
The company I was working with at the time. Yeah. surround it with some homework, some flipped learning, some e-learning before, some maybe coaching or mentoring. And now I've got this blended learning thing. Nope. If you look at all those assets and lay the five moments over, those are all moments one and two assets that I just mixed up from a highly economical perspective. I get it. 2 days of training versus 5 days of on-site. Huge savings. Not arguing it. But don't lob the word blended learning on that. From the learner's perspective, that is still stop what I'm doing, step away mentally or otherwise from the workflow and do this thing, which is cool. I didn't come to you to do it, but I still have the monumental jump of now going back in my work and somehow hanging that on something.
Right.
Right? So, but workflow learning says, no, we're going to keep you while you're in the context of work, to your friend's perspective, and feed you, prompt you, make available a contextual asset that makes, that I'm like, I'm still going to keep going. This thing's popping up and prodding the whole deal. But the deliverable to be consuming this is continuing to perform my job. Does that make
what
sense?
What a novel idea.
Oh my God. It's
how did we not think of that sooner? During the Industrial Revolution, when we needed to train people or something changed or they had a problem, why don't we make them learn while they were working?
Because, you know, because to our credit, you know, we have a big, it's a big responsibility, right? So we have to, and this is why I want to be careful that I honor the legacy of our industry, is that we have a responsibility of doing things in a defendable way.
Sure.
Or else we're being irresponsible. Because some of the things we train on are terrifying and people die from or bad things happen. So you have to lie in bed at night as a designer knowing that I made defendable, responsible design decisions. So what we did we used what we knew worked. And you can't see me on the podcast, but I'm air quoting, right? but did it. I mean, let's step back and say, did it really work? And when you say work, do you mean did it school people up on some great knowledge and some practice and some awareness? Is that what you mean by work? That to us would be mastery. Or does work mean that it was then mentally and transferred to true performance, contextualized? I don't know if it, I would argue it didn't. And so again, the time you described, we were kind of a one-hit wonder, right? But we aren't anymore. This is how we started this conversation. We have these remarkable tools at our disposal. And so shame on us for not stepping back and understanding what they are. There's some emerging methodologies that are remarkable. Five moments in the work that Dr. Gottfredson does. And there's others. We have a responsibility of looking at these. And you know, I wouldn't want a doctor to use leeches anymore. I'd want them to have matured beyond that, even though they worked at one time.
Maggots still have a place.
Yeah.
Let's make a bit of a pivot here. We've talked about the five moments of need and supporting learners in the workflow. We've talked about taking care of them holistically and wellness and the importance of that. Once we've done those things, we need to measure, confirm whether or not what we've done is effective. You're hosting a benchmarking series session on Tuesday morning, first block, I believe it's 8 a.m. Talk a little bit about that session, and then let's see if we can connect those things together.
Yeah, so important. We're gonna get a bunch of people in a room to talk about measurement. What's working, what's not, where are you on the journey, how mature is your measurement strategy. It's not just a room of success stories. You know, we want to get people in the room in various stages of the journey, because there's power in that, in meeting people where they are. And so we talked about this before we actually started the podcast, but I don't want only fives in the room, or three fourths or a third of the people being fives, because the other two thirds are probably ones or twos, right? And becoming the journey from a one or two to a five is
long.
So I want some twos, threes, and fours in there, right? Because if I'm a one, my next step is a two. My next step isn't a five, right? And so we're going to do our best in that day, in that hour, to understand that demographic, and then create a place where some really powerful best practices, crash and burns, lessons learned can be shared, so that depending on where you are in that range, you can get some value.
When we talk about measurement, the Kirkpatrick model and then Jack Phillips' fifth level ROI, however you want to look at that, is the general way that we discuss measurement in learning and development. In one of the organizations I worked, one of the things that we talked a lot about was felt impact. So when we're working with customer service or we're working on an employee engagement program, and sometimes the measures aren't available. Does that type of thing come up in these discussions where it's, how do we talk about the value, the intangible value that's being created, but that we can see, that we have a sense for?
Well, I guess this is kind of a way to bring back around to the five moments in a way, in that I think we have to understand as an industry what different things can really measure and what they can't. Okay, I'm going to get letters for this. I would argue the classroom can't measure well beyond moments one and two. Because it really, you're out of context. Yeah, we practice. Yeah, we simulate. That's not the point. It's not the workflow.
Right.
We give them a great book, or we give them great resources. I'm not disputing any of those, but it's hard to correlate or do causation. All these words that psychometricians use, that 3 months later, because I sat through 3 days of something, I'm performing better. And by the way, that's not an attack of the classroom. In fact, I would argue it's unfair, which happens, that 3 months later someone goes, "I can't do anything." And then they do this.
100%.
That class.
Training was no good. We need to retrain these people.
Wrong. The training for what training does was stunning. If we had stopped at knowledge gain, you came knowing such, and you left knowing more, and up to probably level three of so on, and stopped maybe two. Great. But here's the problem: don't go out into Phillips and the others because I sat through something. Now you have to have something out here, workflow stuff, that I can gauge, measure, survey, get feedback on, and go, okay, yeah, now that you moved from knowledge one and two into performance, apply, solve and such, I can correlate that you consume this object, reference this thing, use this coach, and correlate within the, frankly, that moment that performance changed for the good of the better, right? And so now we, with the full gamut of these things, I think, at least I know in my work, I can finally defend and responsibly measure higher into those measures, and I'm much more comfortable with letting modalities do what they do. And not putting them in positions where they are being asked to measure things or impact things that they really just unfairly or fairly don't.
Sure. Absolutely. So the benchmarking session, again, that's Tuesday morning with Bob. And can't emphasize this enough. How often do we get to get into a room with a bunch of other learning professionals from different industries, different companies, different geographical regions, and talk about what we're doing to justify our existence?
We are the.
I think that's what we're doing in that session.
We are the cobbler's children who have no shoes, right? We are the most caring, wonderful people. That's why I've stayed in this long. Who don't, back to self-help, right? Who don't spend enough time caring for ourselves, letting the learners go for a bit, just having it out in a room with them not listening about our frustrations, our challenges, our fears, our struggles, our failures, and responsibly learning from those, and maybe do a little, you know, wound licking along the way, right?
I'm going to need to show up just for comic material.
Well, that, you know, that's what we're going to try to do. We're going to try to, you know, it's what happens in Orlando stays in Orlando, right? We're going to try to have that candid dialogue around what is the underbelly of measurement right now. What are we doing great? Let's own it. Let's share it. Where are we missing the mark? Which is not a attack. It's where are we missing the mark?
Absolutely.
And maybe we can begin to think of some ways to fill it. So that's what we're going to try to do.
Okay, one last question for you.
Yep.
The first time I heard you speak was in Calgary. It was about 10 years ago. And you opened a keynote with a line something to the effect of, and with impact and with power in your voice, I believe we fundamentally overtrain our people. That was 10 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
How much has it changed, if at all?
Not enough.
Okay.
Not enough. We've been fooled by technology, by modality, again, I want to be careful here, because I've never attacked intent, because I go back to...
I like that about you, because I think sometimes I forget to lob that in or to think through that lens.
Yeah,
it's not the intent that's under attack.
My parents, when I grew up and I did something wrong, the first thing they wanted to pivot on was intent, right? If you meant to hurt or fail or cheat or lie,
right.
Yeah, but if you didn't... And screwed up, then we might want to look at that behavior a bit differently, right? And so our industry, it's hard, harder than it's ever been. But we're so training first focused. And so a lot of people will say, Bob, this whole 5 moments thing sounds great. I have no time to do it. I'm like, then you don't get it. If your answer is you don't have time to do it, because what you're pivoting on is it takes me so long, Bob, which you may not be saying in the sentence is, it takes me so long to build my training now that I don't have time to build this workflow stuff. Stop building training first, and you'll have time. Build workflow stuff first. And guess what? In the end, you'll have less training to build. It's such a simple pivot, but because we can't get out of our own way, and everything is training first, training first, mm-hmm. training first, which again, from the 100 years of doing it, I get, but let's stop the madness. And look at the 5 moments and others. I don't pick a methodology. I don't care what lens. But let's start saying, look, let's pivot on performance first. Let's make a life jacket before we teach swimming. And see if we do it differently. Right? And so when I show someone a well-architected EPSS, when I show somebody an ID, and often when we start our trainings, we show them a stunning 5 moments of need, pyramid-filled EPSS or performance support tool. And we say, look, if you had this first, if you had this, what I just showed you first, and then you knew you had to bring people into a class to train them, would you train them differently than you do now?
Probably.
Oh my, they're like, oh my God, I'd skip, this is what they say, I'd skip half the stuff I teach now. Think of what I just said. I'd skip half the stuff I teach now. Back to your question of overteach. I would skip half the stuff I teach now. Wait a minute, then skip half the stuff you teach now. How dare you keep people in a room, overload them, cognitively bury them, when you just got through saying if you had built this thing first that supports and has all the stuff in it to begin with, and it's intuitive and navigationable, contextualized, so therefore, yeah, I look at my outline and go, nope, not going to cover it, not going to. Clint, why aren't we doing that?
I don't know.
Why aren't we doing
that? I don't know.
It's the deal.
Has the DMV figured this out? Like, for all the grief we give the DMV, and it doesn't matter where you're from, the DMV is the DMV. You get you got a little booklet when I learned to drive. I'm sure it's online now. And you need to learn some really basic rules. That's it. Learn those basic, know what a stop sign is,
yep.
know what a yield sign is, know
yep.
when you're supposed to merge or not supposed to merge, those sorts of things. And once you know those things, get in the car with somebody and go drive.
Yep. We call those critical skills. what we've not, again, this is a whole other thing, but what we've not, the lens I did not look at when I started dissecting content in the way in which I wanted to deliver it. I didn't look at things through criticality, meaning if it doesn't kill you and I give you a good support environment, why wouldn't I let you learn it where learning is done best and has been proven ad nauseum?
There's a lot of sensitivity in the world right now.
Sure.
There's a lot going on.
Yes, there should.
And I think we're in the process of figuring things out in a lot of ways. And so we see that there. And because of that sensitivity, do you think organizations are a bit resistant to just let people fail?
Super risk averse. Okay. Super risk averse. But here's the problem. It's like it's the elephant in the room. You know, I once had a senior person, not a learning person, in a company when we were talking about social learning and its strategy for that. And we mentioned the grapevine. You know, the classic grapevine, right? Every company has them. And he stopped and goes, that thing. I want you to stop that thing. Hate it. We get sued for it. People are, so what I want you to do, and I looked at him and I said, not going to happen. Stop the grapevine? Stop the water cooler discussion or the walking out to the parking lot?
Yeah, how much are you going to spend on the robots?
Yeah, stop that. You know, and so failure, really, we're going to stop failure. But what we can do is we can make it safer, a whole lot safer than we do. And therefore, I think the outcome is inappropriately catastrophic than it could be. Mm-hmm. We have to understand that there are criticality is a gray, not a black and white. So there are things that are we use a rubric of 1 through 7 when we do criticality ratings. And we do that because of that gray scale. And in principle, what we do, Clint, is after we're done doing critical skills analysis, we say, okay, look, if it's a 5, 6, or 7, based on the rubric, and the rubric is tailored to the context of what a 7 would, 7 is like, if you're in the military, 7 is dead. Forfeit of national security. Okay. Mission aborted, right? Those words are in a 7. 1 is no one knows. Lose 5 minutes, right? Minimal, right?
This thing.
When you look at an outline, then, if you will, of content, of performance, it becomes kind of in principle a simple formula. It's like, look, if it's a if you look at what's under the 5, 6, and 7s, what you're saying is to let you learn through trial and error. Well-supported trial and error, but still assuming that there's going to be some failure, those consequences aren't excusable. Those are too bad to let you learn through them. But we just labeled a whole lot of stuff that's a 4 or lower, and you would not believe, even in the most terrifying of environments that we've helped with this design in, just terrifying stuff, there's way more 4s and 1s than you think. And so... But because the title of the thing is terrifying, everything soup to nuts goes in the class.
Absolutely.
Everything goes in the class.
We said that with not even necessarily terrifying, but things like heavy equipment operator programs where just loads and loads of information is getting dumped in the classroom or dumped on people when they're out in the field learning to operate a backhoe or an excavator.
Right.
When a lot of that information, like hand signals, that can be e-learning. There's no reason to lock people in classrooms for that.
Were wrong, right? You gave me two. You said either overload's the problem. We either overload them while they're on that god-awful machine doing things, and therefore they do really terrifying things, or we overload them in the classroom, therefore they leave the classroom overwhelmed and clueless.
Yeah, yeah.
My point is, there's merit in both environments that are instructionally sound and defendable. Let's put the right things in the right place with support. And it's never throwing them to the wolves. I'm going to architect a stunning support environment that I'm going to show you how to use, and it's going to be contextual and available when you're on that backhoe. And it'll work. But I'm not going to say, well, since I built this beautiful thing, no more training. No, because there's things that if I don't know you rotely can do and that I teach why and stuff, you're going to kill someone or hurt someone in the process of learning. That is inexcusable. But what I'm saying is, back to your question about overteach, it's not an all or nothing thing, right? So let's just go math. So the 5 days of training can become 2, But the two are very defendable under the four, not because I want to just make it shorter and not have you to have to come in. So if I'm going to, the 3 days I'm cutting out, so to speak, are still covered, but they're covered while doing
right
in a way that you don't hurt yourself and you learn really well through. And yeah, I have to lick your wounds or get them bare, but those aren't deadly things. But the things that kill you or hurt others or stuff, I'm going to train you on those things. But the cognitive load of all that stuff dispersed where it belongs versus dumping it all in either environment is unbelievable. We've seen training cut in half. We've seen 18, I can't say who, but we saw an 18-month onboarding program become 9 months, and now it's going down to 4. It had to be 18 months when everything was in it. We taught everything. Right? And so let's just look at it through a different lens and balance it, pivoting on performance, overwhelmed and supported by well-designed support, and let the classroom do what it does best.
That's perfect. Thanks so much for doing this, Bob.
Of course.
We really appreciate it.
Of course.
That was Bob Mosher on the Learning 2019 podcast. If you'd like to hear more from Bob, you can find him presenting at Session 104, Workflow Learning, on Monday at 8 a.m. in Yucatan. Session 410, Learning is Global, a panel, also Monday at 3:05 in Monterey 1. And Session 540, Measuring Learning, on Tuesday at 8 a.m. in Coronado PQ. For more episodes of this podcast, search any of the Learning 2019 social media channels for the hashtag L19podcast or subscribe to the eLearning Alchemist podcast on your favorite podcast app. We hope you'll tune in again for more great content from Learning 2019.